$33,000.
They don't turn on grass.
Well, if they do, $300 a year for 5 years.
Yes.
No, the fees are with, we
sorry, sir.
So we, yes, so we get 1.5 million plus.
Good. What's going on?
That was such a
heck yes. By God.
How are you doing, boy?
Good thing.
Chair will call the April 4th, 2017 meeting of the City Council to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Clerk, if you please call the roll.
Alderman Redpath.
Here.
Alderman Senor.
Present.
Doris Turner. Alderman Turner.
Wow. What happened?
Y'all be like that.
I got company and stuff here, and that's what I get. Oh. Oh,
Alderman boy. Turner.
I'm here.
Alderman Fulgenzi.
Here.
Alderman Proctor.
Here.
Alderman Becker.
Here.
Alderman McMiniman. Alderman Tylan. Alderman Donlin.
Here.
Alderman Hanauer.
Here.
Mayor Lightfelder.
Here. Thanks for getting that right. We do have a proclamation for the Lamphere Boys High School team, if you'd like to come up, basketball team.
Mayor, I think it'd be fitting if Alderman Senor read that.
I knew that would come. I knew that would come. And you know what, Rob? I wouldn't have any problem doing that at all.
Is that Alderman Turner?
Congratulations.
So actually, we should give kudos to Herman Senor. He did welcome the team back, and that was nice.
Yes, he did. Yeah, he did.
So as everybody should know, Lamphere High School made it to the state finals, and they represented us well, and we had a nice reception. And Alderman Senor reflects what all of us reflect. It doesn't matter what school you go to, but when we do advance, we cheer on our other schools with regards to that. And they're a great reflection of what Springfield stands for, both on and off the court. So we really appreciate all your good efforts, and especially in the years to come. So I'll read the proclamation if you want to say anything afterwards. And it reads, whereas the achievements of the Lamphere Boys basketball team highlights the commitment, spirit, and pride of the Springfield community and should be recognized, and whereas the Lamphere Boys basketball program is rich in history, like a former Lamphere varsity player named Blake Turner, who said it was a dream come true to be named head coach for the Lions 5 years ago, and whereas the team consisting of Will Bowles, Cardell McGee, Carl Wright III, James Jones, P.J. Edwards, Stanley Morgan, Elijah Malik, Anthony Crump, Jarrell Tarr, Davion Rayford, Marquand Day, and Captains Andre Williams, Corrington Jones, and Yakima Rose show dedication, determination, teamwork, and drive, and their achievements are to be applauded. And whereas 2016 through 2017 marked many victories for the Lions, including a 28-5 record, becoming tournament champions for the Adam Lopez Thanksgiving Tournament, the Pekin Insurance Holiday Tournament, and the City Tournament. Hear that, Alderman Senor?
Yes, sir.
Okay, to see if you're listening. Consecutive regional championships for the last 4 years, Central State Conference champions, sectional champions, and super sectional champions. And whereas the Lions went on to fourth place at the IHSA Class 3A tournament, making these young athletes the eighth team in school history to make it to the IHSA Final Four. And whereas in appreciation of Coach Turner and assistant coaches Philippe Phillips, Isaiah Hale, Tyler Christensen, Artie Taylor, Steve Hunter, Lanphier Principal Artie Doss, and their athletic director Brian Caton, for their mentoring, motivation, and encouragement to the Lions. And whereas hashtag It's Just Different has been a hashtag associated with Lanphier boys basketball team, showing that those who step on the court aren't playing for themselves, but playing for their teammates, school, family, and Lions pride. And whereas Springfield can never underestimate the roar of the Lions, because as senior Will Bowles said, you don't play Lanphier basketball, you live Lanphier basketball. Now therefore, I, James O. Langfelder, Mayor of the City of Springfield and City Council, do hereby proclaim that Tuesday, April 4th, 2017, shall be Lanphier High School Boys Basketball Day in the City of Springfield, and call upon all citizens to formally recognize the great achievements of the 2016-2017 Lanphier Boys Basketball Team and their coaches for their historic run and achievements in representing the City of Springfield.
Thank you. I just want to say that it's really, really, it felt really, really good to get the support from everyone. I know that we all have our rivalries, but we really felt the support from the city as a whole. And I'm just proud to be a Lanphier Lion. We were happy to represent the city, and we thank you for your support. Our captain, Andre Williams, has a shirt that we're going to present the mayor.
I could probably give it to all of us.
we'll get him one. That's a Final Four shirt, and it's signed by the team. Thank you for your support. We appreciate you coming out and supporting us. Thanks to Alderman Senor for his support. I know there's a couple people that are aldermen that are alumni. Thank you guys for your support too. Appreciate it.
As a Lanphier alum and mother of the coach and grandmother of one of the players, I'm extremely proud of these kids, not so much for what they did on the court, but the things that they do off the court. They are seen throughout the community at different schools and community events, volunteering their time. And I also want to say that most of these kids are National Honor Society inductees, so they really are student athletes, and I'm very proud of all of them.
It's like a big family,
it
right?
Is. I'm a little brother, right? They get beat up all the time.
The chair will entertain a motion to dispense with the reading of the minutes of the March 21st, 2017 City Council meeting and approve the minutes.
So moved.
Second. Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay. Motion carries. Chair will entertain a motion to incorporate the pre-council first reading of ordinances into the record of this City Council meeting.
So moved.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. The chair will entertain a motion to incorporate the pre-council reading of the consent agenda into the record of this City Council meeting.
So moved. Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Discussion. I just want to make a point about 143. With the shape that our budget's in, and if we have another situation arise like this, if we have, say we have 10 more situations arise like this, that's possibly $1 million that we could be throwing away, basically. So I think we need to really look at those contracts when they come up, and we need to invoke the right of the city council to approve or not approve those contracts the next time we have one of those come forward, because it would be in the best interest of the city in the long run. Yes, sir.
Your time.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear which one. Were we discussing the one with the local bidder's preference?
Yes, it was.
Sidewalk.
Okay.
2017-143.
I understand, and I guess my comment would be that in this particular case, this particular gentleman having, him being a non-local bidder, not even being a county or a city, but having 8 of his 10 employees be local is rare. Normally that doesn't happen. And I think that Mr. McCarty and prior to him, Mr. Crutcher, did a fantastic job of explaining how local bidder's preference actually benefits the city in the past. And before we as a body get too hasty, I would really appreciate if maybe they presented to us again to maybe explain how local bidder's preference, even the 5% discount on the bid, really does come back the way it does. Maybe that would just be beneficial.
I have no problem with that, but I'm saying in this case, and we need to look at it closely, because with the $70,000 and the extra sidewalk we could get for that $70,000, I think it would behoove us to be more vigilant in how we administer these contracts. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with the process. I'm just saying we as a body need to look at those things closer, because if you want to go a little further, then those people that specifically with this contract, he would buy his materials and things here in the city. So we're losing out money in sales taxes and other things that way also.
Right, and the thing is the 5% discount being a $70,000, $80,000 difference this time is only because of the size of the proposal.
I'm not arguing anything, because I'm just making my own point. And why are we going back and forth? I just wanted to make a point, and I wasn't trying to argue with anybody.
No, I'm just discussing.
Thank you very much.
There's no attack here, Alderman.
Thank you very much.
Alderman Dowling.
Good evening. I didn't raise my hand.
Okay. <This one. laughs> Well, I did have Corporation Council check into it, and I guess in the past there had been a limit. I don't know if you want to go over that, and if any aldermen feel strongly about it, we can always take a look at that approach.
The a little bit of original history with this. When the city first adopted back in the, actually, I believe in the 90s, the original local preference ordinance, was actually a cap put in, so to in effect minimize the potential impact. And the cap back then, as I recall, was $10,000. It would be appropriate in the future if the council wanted to revisit the policy. And Alderman Redpath may actually remember that, because it was a debate with CWLP at the time about it. You know, you can have the preference, but then set a maximum amount you're prepared to set aside on the contract, so you could make it not to exceed $50,000 or not to exceed a set amount that would act both still give a preference but also cap what differential you're willing to accept as a policy between bids. So that would be something maybe for at some point in the future to discuss if you'd like to revisit that.
Right, I'm not challenging anyone's job or the way anyone did their job. I'm just looking at the numbers here.
Well, this would have to be prospective.
Okay.
You know,
right.
It wouldn't affect this.
Right,
but
right.
Going forward, mm-hmm. If you wanted to have a discussion, if you wanted to establish a cap, you could do that. At one time there was one.
That's a very common sense approach.
Thank you very much.
Any other discussion on the consent agenda? All those in?
This is just a motion to incorporate the pre-council reading.
Right, okay. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed say nay. Motion carries. Due to notices going out to taxing bodies with the council date of April 5th, 2017 for annexations, Chair will entertain a motion to remove agendas numbers 2017-146, 2017-147, 2017-148 for continuance until April 18th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay.
Motion carries. With the exceptions of agenda number 2017-146, 2017-147, and 2017-148, Chair will entertain a motion to place it on the consent agenda on final passage.
So moved.
Second.
Been seconded. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor, vote yes. Those opposed, vote no. The voting is now open. Should be shortly.
No pressure, Mike. Frank's looking at his watch.
Turn off the Cub game back there.
We can do a roll call vote, please. Oh, no, they got it. Voting's now open. And the consent agenda passes, 9 voting yes, none voting no. Next item on the agenda is number 2017-152, an ordinance amending Chapter 36 of the 1988 City of Springfield Code of Ordinances as amended by adding Section 36.49, requiring City Council approval prior to across-the-board wage increases to municipal employees not represented by a union. Chair will entertain a motion to place agenda number 2017-152 on final passage.
We skipped part of the agenda.
Oh, we did.
Yeah.
Nope. Number 7.
Yep, sure did. Agenda number 2015-121, 2015-371, 2016-328, 2016-450, 2017-016, 2017-041, 2017-071, 2017-101, 2017-102, and 2017-103 remain tabled or in committee.
Mayor, I'd like to take 071 and move it to the debate agenda.
It's been moved. Is there a second to place 2017-071 on the debate agenda?
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Motion carries. Thank you. 2017-071, an ordinance declaring various parcels of real property to be surplus property, directing the sale of said real property, and authorizing the publication of a notice of said sale and request for proposals.
Under consent.
And move for approval.
Second.
And seconded. Any discussion?
I have a question.
Alderman Turner.
So, refresh my memory. Why was this ordinance placed on? Why was it tabled?
Those were the properties, and I talked to
it made reference to the
purchasing agent. Robinson said he's cleaned it up and changed the language, so it's the properties.
Technically.
Yeah, it was a technicality that was cleaned up by purchasing agent Robinson.
Yeah, Corporation Council would like to clarify some more,
please. I was going to say, I believe this, didn't this relate to that it made reference to part of the parcels on the Y block?
Correct.
And I believe that that issue has been corrected.
That is correct.
That is my understanding.
Yep. Okay.
It's really just a technical question on the properties.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion to approve, vote yes. Those opposed, vote no. The voting is now open. And the ordinance passes, 9 voting yes, none voting no. Next item on the agenda is number 2017-152, an ordinance amending Chapter 36 of the 1988 City of Springfield Code of Ordinances, as amended by adding Section 36.49, requiring City Council approval prior to across-the-board wage increases to municipal employees not represented by a union. Chair will entertain a motion to place agenda number 2017-152 on final passage.
At the request of the alderman who presented the ordinance, since he is not here tonight, he has requested that we return this to committee.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to return to committee. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Motion carries to return the ordinance to committee. Chair will entertain a motion.
Omnibus?
Yep.
on 154, 155, hang on, pages to 154, 155, 156, 157, and 158, please.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to have an ominous vote for agenda number 2017-154, 2017-155, 2017-156, 2017-157, and 2017-158. Any discussion?
Have they been dented, vetted?
None of these participants have any debt with the city at this time.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries. Ordinance number 2017-154, an ordinance approving the reappointment of Larry W. Harville to the Lincoln Library Board of Trustees. 2017-155, an ordinance approving the reappointment of Sarahini R. Nunn to the Commission of International Visitors. 2017-156, an ordinance approving the reappointment of Michael Koppel to the Commission of International Visitors. 2017-157, an ordinance approving the appointment of Harish G. Bahat to the Commission of on International Visitors. 2017-158, an ordinance approving the appointment of Don R. Walton to the Historic Sites Commission. Chair will entertain a motion to place agenda number 2017-154 through 2017-158 on final passage.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and second. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, vote yes. Those opposed, vote no. The voting is now open. And the ordinance is passed of 9 voting yes and none voting no. Next item on the agenda is number 2017-159, an ordinance amending sections 100.30, 100.52, and 110.071 of the 1988 City of Springfield Code of Ordinances as amended to permit City Council to direct money to the corporate fund instead of other designated funds and extending the dates in section 37.05 and 37.06 relating to the capital improvement and equipment funds. Chair will entertain a motion to place agenda number 2017-159 on final passage.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. The chair will entertain a motion to amend agenda number 2017-159.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Discussion on the proposed amendment. What this basically does is ensures that it's just for fiscal year 2018 for this transfer of funds.
That's correct. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.
Any discussion with the ordinance as amended?
I got a question. Is this for the roof?
Yeah.
Yes.
No, originally the first, correct me if I'm wrong.
Okay.
Originally the $750,000 was gonna be for the roof, but we took that out because we're using TIF funds to in lieu of the $750,000.
The change is required because in the appropriation ordinance, the council essentially took money or used money from 095 for the regular budget. These sections of the code need to be corrected to be consistent with that. That's what this is doing.
Thank you.
As far as the amendment goes.
Yes.
So we'll discuss the ordinance after the amendment.
Well, the amendment just sets it for just this year. We can only do it for this year.
And the first order of business would be a vote amendment first, then the ordinance as amended.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
So I guess we'll answer your question once we discuss the ordinance.
Just tell me when to vote no. That's
Where you can vote yes.
Alderman Tyler.
I'd like to thank the sponsors for requesting this amendment. You've heard my concerns. I have no animosity toward what you guys are doing. I just don't agree with it. I appreciate the amendment. I will still be voting no, as I've said, but thank you.
Any other discussion on the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries. Discussion on the ordinance as amended. So in answer to Alderman Becker's question, Director McCarty.
Sure.
So the budget originally proposed by the mayor had $750,000 for the roof project on this
on the other building, Municipal Center East. During the budget discussions and negotiations and as final, as it was passed, the $750,000 originally slotted out of the Capital and Infrastructure Fund 95 was moved over as a subsidy to the corporate fund to help balance the budget. And I believe it's the sponsor's intention to come back and to propose using TIF dollars for the roof on Municipal Center East. This particular ordinance just lifts the restrictions for 1 year to move money out of the infrastructure fund over to corporate as a subsidy.
Any other discussion?
Corporation Council, is what we're using the money for a legal use for that money, being TIF funds?
This does not address the TIF issue. It would be my view that if an ordinance is presented and passed using TIF funds to pay for the renovation of the municipal roof, I believe that is a legal use of TIF money.
Then any other discussion? We did have someone from the public sign up to speak, Carol Needler. If you'd like to state your name and address for the council, we'd appreciate it.
I'm Carol Needler. I live at 2016 South 4th Street, and I'm asking you to vote against ordinance 2017-159 and 2017-160, and I'm speaking for Springfield Icon, inner city older neighborhoods. When I polled the Icon Steering Committee about these issues, every one of them expressed concerns. We had questions, we got our questions answered, and we are recommending against this for several reasons. We are in competition with visionary neighbor cities for economic development, businesses, jobs, and residents. A little over a month ago, we asked you to approve tax increases that would have put Springfield on par with surrounding communities. You rejected that solution. As aldermen of the city of Springfield, you're more than just order takers. You're standard bearers for a vision of a sustainable, competitive city. Instead of asking constituents if they want more taxes, we ask you to make the case about why we need more taxes. As Alderman McMiniman did that night, in support of reasonable, responsible spending to protect our investment in our infrastructure. The funds provided by the change in 2017-160 aren't enough. Instead of taking a best practices approach, a real equipment purchasing strategy, it's a band-aid that delays needed public works equipment and forces an artificial budget and timeline. Finally, it decreases infrastructure improvements that were promised to voters in exchange for increased gambling within the city. We're asking you not to renege on your promise that gaming revenue will go to Fund 95 for infrastructure. Can we trust you to keep your word or not? Once again, ICON is asking, what's the vision? Where's the leadership? You can do better. Please vote no. Thank you.
Any questions? Any other discussion on the ordinance as amended? All those in favor of the ordinance as amended, vote yes. Those opposed, vote no. The voting is now open. And the ordinance passes 7 voting yes, 2 voting no. Next item on the agenda is 2017-160, an ordinance amending section 110.071 of the 1988 City of Springfield Code of Ordinances as amended to provide dedicated revenues for the purchase of capital equipment for the Office of Public Works. Chair will entertain a motion to place agenda number 2017-160 on final passage.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and second. Any discussion?
Yes, please.
All right. I'm sorry. Chair will entertain a motion to amend agenda number 2017-160.
So moved.
And the amendment is,
Yes, sir. The amendment is just a technical amendment to make it consistent with the prior ordinance. It removes the language that references unless otherwise approved by the City Council, since you did not adopt that on the other ordinance. So it's just striking that language so it's consistent.
So moved. Is there a second on the amendment?
Second.
Been moved and second. Any discussion? on the ordinance, or I'm sorry, on the amendment? All those in favor, Alderman Turner?
So this amendment, it is basically the same as the ordinance, $500,000 a year for 10 years.
Correct. That's correct. The way it was drafted originally, it tied the two, the previous ordinance and this one together. And so they removed the language with regards to approval by the city council. So the intent of the ordinance is, as was originally, was to spend $500,000 a year for 10 years for public works equipment. And Director McCarty is, he can explain the scenario with regards to the purchases after we pass the amendment or as we go forward.
But this amendment makes it a one-time event now instead of opening the doors.
It's not a one-time event
no.
if it's every year for
well,
10 years.
Well, the 10-year, looking at this item as a whole, by removing the unless otherwise approved, means
I understand that.
Right, I'm asking Jim.
We'll have Corporation Council explain it.
Please. I'm asking if that's what it does.
Yeah.
That is correct. We were simply, when the ordinances were drafted, keep in mind, this is a section in the city code. So in order to make sure they fit together, the original ordinance that was just voted on had that language, so we tried to make the language consistent in all the sections. Since that did not pass, then we need to remove that language so we're consistent with the previous ordinance. Now, when the amendment, if the amendment is passed, then the debate would be the entire section, because there was no section of the city code actually setting aside the video gaming monies for infrastructure, for 095. So that sets it aside and sets aside or then directs that the $500,000 per year be done. That's the second part of this. The amendment is just technical to make it comply with the prior ordinance.
Any other discussion on the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment, say aye. Alderman Senor.
So this is not just $500,000 for 1 year, it's $500,000 a year for 10 years?
Mm-hmm. The amendment doesn't say that. The entire ordinance does, but first you would have to address just the technical change with the amendment. So the amendment would be voted on first, then the debate on the
ordinance.
On the entire ordinance.
If we wanted to amend this to go to a lower amount for a shorter period of time, we would want to wait until after this amendment is
that
passed,
is correct.
And then we want to
then
pass
you can make a
new amendment.
Further, you can make a further amendment if some other language was
okay.
Requested.
All right.
Any other discussion on the amendment?
So, refresh my memory on
yeah,
the
this. Yeah, I agree, Alderman Senor. I'm with you on that. What it does is, originally when the ordinances were drafted, Corporation Council drafted in a way where if both ordinances were passed, it goes across all sections of the code. So that was the original. But by putting in the restriction on one fiscal year, you know, 2018 on the previous ordinance, what this amendment does is take out that language with regards to exceptions made by City Council, you know, with regards to the approval of the original proposal, which was $500,000 a year for 10 years to purchase the equipment. So it just mirrors, it's trying to get the code straight with what was just passed. Is that correct, Council?
Yes. And if the amendment is passed, then you would debate, you know, the appropriateness of the capital equipment expenditures and then also the amounts and length of time.
Any other discussion on the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Okay, discussion on the ordinance as amended. One thing I'd like is for Director McCarty to clarify, I believe when the initial infrastructure bonds were issued and the projections of video gaming, how much were you projecting a year to come in for video gaming revenues?
Well, initially when video gaming was brought into the city, we didn't have any basis to go off of, so our estimates were somewhere in the million and a half range, something like that.
It was more on the million range from my previous discussions.
Right.
They're coming in at 1.75?
1.75, correct. We are currently experiencing about $1.5 million in tax revenue and another $225,000 a year in license and registration fees.
And we haven't spent down any of the video gaming as of yet since it's been put in place.
The correct. Only thing I'll have to go back and look and see if it was spent, but I do believe that the council authorized $300,000 in usage for the overhead sewer program. Whether okay, or not that was right. utilized, I do not know right. at this point.
So on the projections originally, they were utilizing $1 million. So the to think that the allocation for these this $500,000 each year for 10 years, we're already how many years in effect on video gaming?
Three or four, I think.
4 years.
We have about $5.5 million.
Yeah, and these are revenues above and beyond what was originally projected. So we're covered with regards to the projection. So if we keep bringing in $1.5 million each year for the remaining 5 years, or you know, for the duration of 10 years, then it's not going to have an impact on the projected infrastructure plan that was set out a few years back. Alderman Tylan, then we'll go around the horn.
I guess my question comes in. We've had similar discussions on things like this before, and I was talking to Alderman Proctor, and I felt that maybe it's, in my mind, it's almost a technicality, but we have bought equipment before using similar funds like this when the equipment was necessary to do the work. So for me, I almost feel like, other than the fact that you're wanting to use this money to bond out and buy everything now, and you're just trying to secure financing for the bonding, couldn't they already buy the equipment using this fund if it's being used for the purposes of infrastructure improvements?
If the council would choose to, I guess Director Mahoney probably should come up, and I think there's going to be a question on your needs with That's regards to trucks question. And how long yes. it takes to get the equipment in, things of that nature.
Because I feel that we've had this discussion before with mm-hmm. the previous council, and the previous council at that time voted that, and it wasn't here recently last year, it was under Houston. We had a discussion like this where equipment fell under the same category.
Although I don't recall, it may be a question, maybe Director McCarty, but I don't think we used infrastructure funds, Fund 95, for those purchases. There's two rounds of equipment purchases, and I think that was at a corporate fund. But
correct. Mm-hmm. That's correct.
Well, I thought it was a couple of specific instances, things that we were looking at. Nope. But maybe it was farther back, maybe it was under that one. But
there was no video gaming money then.
No, not video gaming. We had other special funds that were dedicated for infrastructure. Taxes or other things.
Under debt, actually, the original 0.25% infrastructure sales tax that was passed back 2009 or whenever it was, mm-hmm. way back, was designated the council very adamantly, and you called a discussion that it would be set aside for infrastructure only. There was a move to take $900,000 from that, and they did take that $900,000, not for equipment, I don't think. It was put back into the fund or something else, into the corporate fund. The Houston administration in that first budget paid back that $900,000. Director McCarty may know better than I, but I believe that was refunded to Fund 95 at that time.
But I guess
I think that's what you're talking about.
I guess the technical part of this question then is, and I don't know whether it's for you, Director McCarty, or Mr. Zirkel, is would these equipment purchases, since they're necessary to do the infrastructure improvements, would they already be part of an applicable expense for this fund?
I'll leave it up to the accountant.
Yeah, I'd let Corporation Counsel answer that.
Yeah. Uh-oh, I'm being passed.
Did you say the accountant?
Accountant, yes.
Oh, well, okay, so right. from my perspective, then I think the answer is if it fits within the constraints and the purpose of the funds, then yes, you can do that. Prime example would be that we have some personnel funded out of Fund 95 that are engineers who work on infrastructure projects right now. And we've not had to do a special ordinance to do that. We simply just have to get council's approval through appropriations in order to do it. So one could argue that this would be the same thing if the council would agree that this is an intended purpose of the funds. That's my reading of the situation, but I'm not the city attorney.
And then I guess my follow-up question is, in the intended purchases for this capital equipment fund that's coming out of this money, is all of this equipment going to be used for road and street and sewer infrastructure improvements, or is there additional equipment that was being intended to be purchased with this money?
We can barely do the stuff you listed there. Yeah, that's the only thing it's going to be used for.
That's just the two technical pieces that I wanted to answer. Yes. Thank you.
And then the sewer side is on a separate, they're on their own fund, so it's a totally different issue. So.
Alderman Redpath?
Mayor, I'd like to entertain a floor amendment, if I could, please. I'd like to change
Can we finish discussion first on...
Absolutely.
Yep. I think Alderman Turner?
I guess I disagree, respectfully disagree.
Well, that's right.
That
won't be the first time. It might not be the last either.
Because keep in mind, when we first voted on the video gaming, which was probably four years ago, we were the only game in town. Now, everybody throughout the county has video gaming. People don't have to come to Springfield to partake in video gaming. There's video gaming in Rochester, Chatham, Southern View, Leland Grove, Jerome, all of the surrounding communities. There's video gaming on every corner. So it's not a selective opportunity where you have to pick and choose where you go. So when you look at the fact that we've had about $1.5 million into that fund every year up until now, that is going to decrease substantially over the next couple of years. We may not see it for a couple of years, but it is going to decrease substantially. So, you know, we just have to keep that in mind when we're looking 10 years out. 10 years out, we're not going to have $1.5 million coming into that fund every year.
Alderman Fulgenzi?
Get him out of the way.
I respectfully disagree. I don't see how we can predict how much anyone wants to gamble. The thing I found out is that people will gamble when they want to, and you're not going to stop them. They're going to do it. And the river boats, for example, have taken a big hit. People would rather spend $20 in a gaming machine in Springfield than to spend $20 for gas to go to Peoria.
I do not disagree with that. I think you misunderstand my point. My point is not the amount of money that people will spend gambling. My point is they have many more opportunities and offerings with which to spend that money. So before, people had to come into the city of Springfield. Now they don't. People that live in Chatham can stay in Chatham. People that live in Leland Grove don't have to go across the street. They can stay in Leland Grove. So you're probably going to see the same number of people participating and spending the same amount of money. It's just, instead of it being divided amongst 10 places, it's going to be divided among 50 places, which means all 50 of those places are going to receive a smaller amount of money.
I don't see how you can come up with the scenario that we're going to end up with less money in 2 years. That's looking into the future, and I just don't see we can do that.
Any other discussion on the ordinance as amended?
Yeah, Mr. Mayor.
Yep, Alderman Proctor.
If Director Mahoney can go through the needs, because my take on this is that it's great that we're pooling the money together to repair stuff, but then if the equipment keeps breaking down, then it's harder to get out there and do it. It would reduce the services to this, you know, to the constituency, the residents of Springfield, that it won't get done timely because the equipment keeps failing. And it just won't get done. So can you kind of go through really quick what
you're... Sure. Yeah, I mean, and we talked about our equipment needs, and I think most people understand that they're dire, and I know the police and fire are in a bad situation as well. We're at the point now that with our dump trucks, I always say, the workhorse of our fleet, we have about 30 of those, about 27 that are operational, the full-size dump trucks, and we have dump trucks that are probably 1999, 2000. The best practice, when we go up to Moline and see how they do the business, they have a designated fund that they fund every year, and they turn their trucks over every 7 to 8 years. That's best practice. So we're like three times past that. So we're having a lot of trucks that spend a lot of time down at fleet. There's cost to that. There's a lot of discussions with fleet about, does it make sense to make this repair? We've had trucks where the frames have rusted out and we've scrapped it at the device of fleet. They're just not safe. So those are causing operational issues. Street sweepers, we have two street sweepers up. When they're down, you know, obviously this time of year is the busy time of year. We try to keep them up and going, and fleet works with us on that. But you know, in that situation, you know, we're very limited on equipment, so we don't have backup equipment. So it's really across the board. We need backhoes, we need heavy equipment. So it's we need pickup trucks that are, we drive 1999 pickup trucks that for our foremen. And we get to the point during a snow season, not this year because we didn't have a lot of snow, but 2 years ago, where we were down a person or down a piece of equipment, we had to send somebody home. We're scrambling to put them in a truck, and the pickup wouldn't work, wouldn't start, and we had a lot of issues. So you're right, it's impacting operations because we don't follow best practices, and not even close to best practices. And what we're proposing for our funding is probably about half where we should be for best practices, and we know we're never going to get there. This would help. Now, I say all that, and I want to shoot myself in the foot on this, but we also have dire infrastructure needs, too. And we're talking about the money we're using for our infrastructure program this year, 12 to 13 million. The idea was to set this money aside so we have a maintenance program that doesn't get us in the situation we were like four years ago. So it's kind of, we desperately need the equipment, but we are desperately in need of infrastructure money for the streets, the sidewalk programs that we talk about every year too. So the more we take from that fund, we'll have all those programs. It'll just be a little less to spend over the of course, the 10 years on that program as well, so.
Yeah. Alderman Hanauer?
What's a dump truck cost, or what the big dump trucks cost?
Doing if we get a hook lift, or 175 to 200,000.
And then originally in the budget, it was proposed that we got a different type of truck. Can you talk about that? What do they cost, and what's the
hook lift trucks you're talking about? So you could use, basically in the wintertime, you'll put a V-box spreader, helps with the salt, and then turn it to a dump bed for most of the year. Mm-hmm. We have some issues with that because it kind of ties them up a little bit in the wintertime, but on and off, there's a little time commitment to that, and plus the price. So because we have limited funds, we're really after, wanting to see if this is passed. We put so many equipment plans together and nothing has come as far as on the funding side. So what we're trying to do now is if there's funding and we know what it's going to be, we'll probably sit down with Fleet, OBM, ourselves internally, and kind of work through what is the best piece of equipment that we can get for a dollar. We have a piece of equipment called the Versa Handler we use to pick up branches. And we've been talking about, is there a better piece of equipment out there that we can replace that with that is more efficient and less costly? The Versa Handler is made, I think, first come from branch. So there's a lot of, once this passes, or if it does pass, we have a funding, and we know we're going to be able to get equipment, we're going to sit down and try to put the pencil to paper and really come up with, you know, a best bang for our buck. So we've had some of that discussion already, but we need to do a little more.
Okay, thank you.
And how much is that all-purpose truck?
The hook lifts run at probably about $200,000.
Okay. Alderman Repeth, do you have
a
okay? Alderman Senor, and then Fulgenzi.
Director, have you put together a wish list yet of what equipment that would be priority for you to get?
We put our Christmas list together probably 50 times, but nothing ever happens with it. So we have a wish list. It's beyond a wish list now. It's almost a desperation replacement list.
And forgive me for being so, I guess, inept or silly, but why are we still at this point? How come we don't have a program in place where we have the equipment funded and it's perpetually funded, and so we're not in this situation? I can't understand why we're still doing this now in this day and age. I'm not directing that at you, I'm sorry. Yeah, but I'm just,
I can't
talking
answer
out
that.
Loud.
I have some thoughts.
I mean, because it seems like we're going to spin our wheels for the next 10 years just throwing money out there to and correct me, Director McCarty, if I'm wrong, we're just throwing out money out there to get equipment and finance buying new equipment, and then at the end of 10 years we're going to have to be in the same place again. So I mean, am I wrong or am I right?
No, we're in a situation where it's piecemeal. You're absolutely correct. Part of the mayor's proposal was to set up a perpetual equipment funding source. It did not pass, and so we are in a process now of trying to figure out how we can get Public Works some equipment, and given the fact that this is dedicated for infrastructure, this was the mayor's decision to go this direction. And one technical aspect I did want to update provide for Alderman Tylan, part of this ordinance, what it does is it moves the money from the sub-account, the video gaming sub-account, over to Fund 94, which is our equipment, capital equipment fund. And from that, we would do the appropriation, come back to the council with an appropriation at the same time that we would come back with the borrowing agreement that we would enter into in order to purchase this equipment.
And then in answer to your question, Alderman Senor, the good news is 10 years from now, Everybody's term limited out. So that's one thing. But the other, the other item, really, the frustration with Director Mahoney is, like he said, he's put plans together, and we can wait for that perfect plan, which never comes. And so this is the best solution we have at hand at this point in time, since the tax increases didn't go anywhere. So that's why we came forward with this proposal. Alderman Fulgenzi?
No, I just want to say that I think we need to get the equipment for the Public Works Department. You can't do infrastructure work without the equipment, and that's a primary thing.
Okay. I got a question.
Yes, Alderman Becker?
What are we going to do about the fire and the police?
They're on their own.
Yeah, this is the reason we are using the video gaming just for Public Works is because they do carry out the infrastructure. That's what the intended purposes of the funds are for, infrastructure improvements. You have to have equipment to do that. And so that's the reason we're dedicating all the funds towards Public Works. Alderman Turner?
No, no
more. Ready?
Alderman Redpath?
Mayor, I'd like to entertain a floor amendment. I'd like to change the funding source, the funding amounts from $500,000 a year for 10 years to $300,000 for 5 years. That is my motion.
Is there a second on
second.
The moved and second. Any discussion? I guess I'd ask Director McCarty, how's that impact, or Director Mahoney, how's that impact?
I think I would ask Director Mahoney.
Sure.
We can certainly do some type of borrowing program with any amount of money. I think it's more the need that's the concern for the director.
Yeah, well, what was, I'm sorry, did it is $300,000 for 10 years?
For 5 years.
5 years.
$300,000 for 10 years?
So it's $1.5 million.
Well, a truck's $200,000, so we would get whatever that pencils out to.
I mean, seven trucks, seven and a half trucks.
Million for 3 years or 5 years.
So, yeah. I think our thought was, we've been discussing with OBM a little bit, is we probably would initially do some borrowing to last a larger amount of equipment out the gate. So that would allow us to go get several trucks, some other pieces of equipment. We talked about replacing the Versa handlers. Under that scenario, I'm not sure I would defer to Director McCarty, but there's not much really to work with there, probably.
No, you have seven trucks.
You know what, the way I see this is the boats aren't there for the 10 years, $500,000, and I'd like to at least try to get something through there. $300,000 for 5 years is better than nothing.
Yeah, well, that's up to you guys. I mean, we'll take what we can get, which has been nothing usually. So,
Alderman Senor? Nope, just praying. That's good. I'm praying too.
My mother would be glad. I'm praying.
Any other discussion on the amendment to change it to $300,000 a year for 5 years? All those in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay.
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 Motion passes. Any discussion on the ordinance as amended? All those in favor of the motion as amended, vote yes. Those opposed, vote no. The voting is now open.
Sneak slow on the gun. There goes that bonus, Mike.
And the ordinance passes as amended, 8 voting yes, 1 voting no. Chair will entertain a motion to suspend the rules and place on first reading agenda number 2017-181, ordinance authorizing the creation of first responder home purchase and new construction grant program in the Enos Park Neighborhood Tax Increment Financing District, utilizing Enos Park Neighborhood Tax Increment Finance funds in the amount not to exceed $100,000 for Office of Planning and Economic Development.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and second. Any discussion?
Yeah, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Alderman Proctor.
I guess with your permission, add me as a co-sponsor.
Sure. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Chair will entertain a motion to suspend the rules and place on first reading agenda number 2017-182, an ordinance authorizing the creation of a Enos Park Exterior Rehabilitation Program in the Enos Park Neighborhood Tax Increment Financing District for exterior rehabilitation purposes, utilizing Enos Park Neighborhood Tax Increment Finance funds in an amount not to exceed $250,000 for the Office of Planning and Economic Development.
So moved.
Been moved.
Second.
Seconded. Any discussion?
Is this new funds, or are we using funds that we've already dedicated to them?
These would be dedicating the TIF funds for the Ennis Park TIF.
Second.
This is to put it on first reading so we can discuss it in committee as a whole.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor, same deal with the commission as co-sponsor.
Sure. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Motion carries. Is there any unfinished business to come before the city council? With regards to new business, a couple items. One, the police chief would like to come up and talk about the new class that you brought in, chief. We swore in seven new recruits, and then also police recruitment is going on right now for the new list, and that's anybody interested, go to springfield.il.us and gather the information for the recruitment process. But I didn't know if you wanted to say anything about the new class sworn in today. Or
we swore in seven new officers today, all graduated from the Illinois State Police Academy last Thursday. They're at our academy currently training. In about 2 to 3 weeks, they'll hit the streets for their 20-plus week FTO program. They're desperately needed. Right now, we're running about 32 people short. When you count all the people that we have in training, people that we have gone to the military, and people we have on light duty. So when you add that up, it's somewhere around almost 15% of our workforce short. So while they're gladly welcomed and needed, they won't be ready to go solo patrol for almost a year. So they don't cut on our manning, they don't help with our manpower situation that we currently have. In addition to that, we have five that'll be getting cut loose probably end of April, first part of May, so that'll help a little bit. We have 10 currently out on light duty or injury status. That'll be a few. We still have two going to the military. And then we have five that we hired effective yesterday that'll be starting the academy on Sunday. So again, takes about a year to hire these people and get them trained up, the exception being a few laterals here and there that we pick up, or pre-service guys or girls that can start into the FTO program at a quicker pace. But again, it's about managing our people. We'll get by and do what we gotta do. There's no risk to the community or to the safety out there. But again, it's just one of those things that as we go through, people be aware that when we hire somebody, that doesn't have an immediate impact on the streets or on our manpower levels.
Alderman Tyler.
Actually, if the chief could step when you're finished with this topic, I have another one.
Sure.
No. With that go on, as the mayor said, we just opened our recruiting process and application process for the next testing cycle. I think the dates are the 16th and 17th of June. Orientations will be kicking off next week, running through that time period. The deadline to apply, off the top of my head, I believe, is May 21st, Julia. Is that correct? May 21st. So if you know somebody who's interested, the sooner they apply, you apply online, you get your study guide, there's practice physical scheduled for April 29th. I would strongly encourage everybody to go to. If you know somebody who might be interested, let me know. We'll have a recruiter reach out to them.
Alderman Senor.
Chief, I want to commend you for your efforts. I was at the ceremony today, and I applaud you and your staff for the outreach that you have done, and I think you need to pass that on to them for me. Thank you very much.
No problem. Thanks.
Alderman Tyler.
Chief, one of the things that I wanted to bring up under new business tonight was I've had several discussions with my NPOs in the area, and I know that it's not just Ward 8, it's all over the city, but I wanted to kind of get it out there for the people who are listening and paying attention. Since December, we have had an increase in the amount of burglaries and crimes of opportunity. The people, usually young kids, going down the entire street, testing every single car handle, checking for anything that's open, anything they can grab. From what I understand, in the last 90 days, there's only been one that's actually been a smash through the window. Everything else has been open car doors. Residential burglaries, there's been one or two with cut screens. Other than that, it's been open doors and open windows. Officer Matt Goulet put something together for several of my neighborhood associations detailing, once again reminding people, if you have a large item purchase, don't advertise it. Cut up your cardboard boxes, put them in the recycle bin. You don't have to tell everybody what you bought. Make sure you're locking your doors. Double check your door before you walk away. Number, when it comes to your car, don't leave anything out in plain sight. If you're going in for the night, put it in the trunk, cover it up, put it where it's not. Take it inside. Don't leave the thing there for somebody to notice. Number four, if you're leaving your property, make sure that you're not leaving first floor windows open. Close the first floor windows. Would you like to add anything to that?
No, just most of the time when you're talking about theft or burglaries, typically there are crimes of opportunity. People don't want to get caught. So what you'll see out there is, like you're saying, unlike vehicles, easy targets, unlike homes, et cetera, the common sense approaches you're talking about is what we encourage everybody to do. That includes closing your garage door, et cetera. You know, it comes down to making yourself less of a victim or less of an opportunity to be a victim.
And I have to confess, I'm not sure how it happened because I usually make sure it beeps when I head inside. But last month, my car was among the ones that got hit on our street. I don't know how they tossed the car. I could tell that because a few things were moved around, but there was nothing in there that they took. They were looking for money. They were looking for, they ended up, the other thing which Officer Goulet pointed out is that I guess there's been two or three cars that have been stolen because people leave their keys in the car. So if you're leaving your key in the car and leaving it unlocked, I think you kind of are, I don't know if that's a trying to get an insurance claim out of it or what, but.
No, you are correct. It's not a wise idea. Some people, for various reasons, leave keys hidden in the vehicle. People know that they look under your floor mats, they look in your glove box, et cetera. It's just not a wise thing to do. Take the extra step, go out of your way. If you're gonna let somebody borrow your car, just take the key, go out of the way and do that. But again, these crimes of opportunities, they typically occur when it comes to theft and burglaries in the daytime when people are working. Again, the thing I would say that as a neighborhood, look out for each of your neighbors. Pay attention, you know what's unusual, what's not unusual. You know what's out of place, what's not out of place. So there are people that are retired that are home. Communicate with them. Start a neighborhood watch. If you'd like to do that, we can put you in touch with one of our NPOs that can help you get that started. But again, it's about just making yourself less of a victim. And don't be afraid to call. I can't tell you how many times people will say, wow, I thought about calling, but I didn't call. We would rather come check it out and it be nothing than to let it go by and actually be something.
That being said, is there a phone number that you would like if people want to try to start a neighborhood watch? Do you have a phone number that they can call?
Yeah, they can call 788-8325, the front desk, and they'll put them in touch with the appropriate people.
Thank you.
Or they can call my office, either one.
Alderman Proctor?
Yeah, just really quick. You're chief. You're good. Thanks. I just really quick for Mr. Mahoney, or Director Mahoney. You don't need to come up. No, I'm sorry. Just the 300 block of North Grand, Family Dollar. There's been numerous complaints. I got calls and stuff, and I guess it hasn't been addressed yet, fly dumping, that sort of nature. If you can send a crew out and inspect that again, I appreciate it.
Any other new business? I do have a couple other items. Earth Awareness Fair is at the Old State Capitol from 1 to 5 on Saturday, April 22nd. And then City of Water Light Power, they're having a public forum at the Beach House on Wednesday, April 19th from 5:30 to probably 7:30. So I think the discussion then will be on the water, I believe, but it's potpourri time. So
Mayor,
we invite everybody to come out for that. And the other item with CWLP, the Energy Authority is going to do a impact analysis of the natural gas plant in Pawnee and how that will impact you know, their best projection possible and how that would impact City Water Light and Power.
Mayor.
Alderman Hanauer?
Did we ever, John, I guess I'll get you up here, been awful quiet. Did we ever get a bid on the Energy Authority? We were supposed to, I had asked that went out for bid, and did it, all that get done?
Yeah, it's got done, and we actually have received the RFPs. We're finalizing the analysis as we speak, or I would imagine within the next couple of weeks we'll be bringing something in front of the council.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Alderman Senior.
On April 20th, is it all right if I speak and I say nothing about Lanfear?
Okay. Sure.
On April 22nd, Springfield Fire Department, American Red Cross, is going to have another smoke detector installation, and it's going to be at our school starting at 10 o'clock, Chief, or 9
o'clock?
Yes. Starting at 10 o'clock. And we'd like anybody that's available to come out and help.
Great. Any other new business? We do have a person signed up, James Johnson. Would you like to come up and state your name and address if you so choose for the council? We'd appreciate it.
Yeah, Mayor. My name is James Johnson. I want to speak on behalf of the police department. Well, not on behalf. I want my comments to be about the police department. And now that the dust has settled from the incident that didn't make many of us very happy, I want you guys to know a few things. But then, first of all, I want you to ask yourselves, about a year and a half ago, maybe almost 2 years, when we had that town hall meeting and TV20 played my clip, we don't want them type of officers in our neighborhood. You remember that? We don't want those officers in our neighborhood. And there's been some meetings here where I felt like some of y'all really didn't believe the community when they came up here and spoke on some things. So my question, and granted, I know you can't speak and talk because everything is still under, you know, investigation and all of that, so I don't expect anything, but I just want you to ask yourself, do you believe us now when we come up here and say something?
That's what the body cameras are for.
Do you believe, even before the body cameras, when we were trying to tell you that there's some things out there that goes on that you don't hear about, that we know about, and we wanted to stop? So thank God for the body cameras. But let me stop and say that we support the chief. We like his actions of what he did. And since the media is listening and they'll take what I say and twist it, all officers aren't bad. Let me make that real clear. Because I know our media in this town. There's some good officers out there and we appreciate their work and service. But I've told you before that there's some out there we don't want in our neighborhood. And I mean that. And if you think that's the first incident, you're fooling yourself. Now, I was all right with it until the attorney got on TV20. I think his name is Dan. And he wanted everybody to not pass judgment because one officer had a bad day. I had to pause a long time before I came to y'all after that. Because if you have a bad day, and if you think you can take it out on somebody and beat 400 on the east side in Ward 2 or Ward 3 or anywhere in our city, that's just not gonna fly. You don't want your daughter or your son to get beat up by a school teacher because he had had a bad day. You don't want your coworker to have a bad day and come and bash you in the face. Or do you? Or better yet, let me have a bad day and come to your office and take it out. Especially for Dan, the attorney who's representing this officer. I'm appalled that he even had the nerve to even say that. A bad day is when one of our servicemen steps on an IED and loses his legs or his arms and body part. That's a bad day. Or when they die in combat, that's a bad day. But the chief know how I feel, and I'm letting you know, because our community ain't really been heard from. You know, that area where this incident happened, ain't nobody. Nobody's really spoke out because we appreciate the steps that's been taken. But I want that attorney to know, and I want you guys to know that this kind of action cannot happen. Cannot ever happen again. Because the outcome will be different. It will be different. He's not welcome ever again in our community or our city. And I can say this, he's not gonna be welcome. Any officer think that they can do that and get away and that is cool, It's not. And he's not going to be well. And if you guys think you have problems downtown with those fights, let some more of those type of incidents that got caught on camera happen again, it's not going to be pretty for Springfield. So all I want to say in the end is we appreciate the body cameras. And Mayor, one more step, and you can pass this on to the school district. We want all our resource officers in the school district to have body cameras.
Absolutely.
We want all our resource officers to have body cameras. Because like I told you about a year and a half ago, that some stuff's happening. Let's try to be preventive instead of reactive. Let's be proactive now. And Mayor, because there's cameras and media here, there's some things that I want to share with you and Mr. Herman off the mic, because I have to be careful what I say when they are around. You know how they twist things. So you got a question?
I just have a statement. I hope that you're not, my understanding is that the attorney, the Dan, is not related with the city. He is.
That's correct.
He's representing the officer. So I just want to make it clear that he's not from the city. Okay. And he was not city hired because of the actions the officer has to get outside counsel. So this is his own attorney.
Right.
It's not associated with the city.
All right. Well, thank you. I didn't know that. It really didn't matter. But if he gets this tape or watch news, if they play anything, then he'll know how the community feel, or at least how I feel.
I understand, but it's just, I don't want anyone out there thinking that the city
okay, that's
is associated well with the attorney.
And to clarify, the attorney involved, I think, is his criminal defense attorney. So he has a certain obligation to his client to speak on behalf of his client, mm-hmm. but he does not represent the city of Springfield.
All right, thanks. That's all I have.
Thank you.
Mayor, as soon as you two can talk to me, the sooner the better.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else wish to address the council? Pollard? If you'd state your name and address for the council, we'd appreciate it.
Thank you. My name is Polly Poskin. I live at 2361 South 7th Street in Harvard Park. So I don't want this to sound, you know, sort of like a blanket criticism or something that we can go back on and fix, but if there's an opportunity, maybe we can do something. I think, as everybody here knows, we're going to be putting in, thankfully, a bypass at 9th and Ash, okay, just like we have a lovely one there at 9th and Capitol between 9th and 11th. So one of the things that happens there at 9th and Ash is that 9th Street will become a dead end, all right? And, well, it should, I mean, right? The complication is we have a E6, we have a fire station on 9th Street, which may be about, what, a block, not even a whole block, a little bit over maybe a block south of Ash. So understandably for the fire department, they got to have an exit. I mean, it's not good to have a fire station on a dead-end street, and these folks, our firefighters, are going to have to access Ash as quickly as they can. So I learned at the most recent public hearing that IDOT and I think the city and so forth collaborates on, that there's a proposed right-of-way that will connect 9th and 10th, so it'll run east and west, parallel to Ash, about two lots south of Ash. Now, part of the complication there is, I think when you're creating a right-of-way for the fire department to use, which is understandable and necessary, you've created a right-of-way for anybody to use. Anybody can come off of Ash, quickly turn on the 10th, and then quickly go west, you know, on the right-of-way to 9th, or come off of 9th, join up with that little right-of-way, shoot over to 10th, and quickly go out to Ash. I think that's a complication. I don't think that's safe. I don't think that's going to be very viable for the neighborhood. I think it's going to create an access in a kind of a, you know, quick fashion That could be harmful to the woman whose house will be about 20 feet, maybe 15 feet to the south of that right away. And just sort of generally in the neighborhood in terms of how traffic could flow using what we had called in the old days a shortcut. So I don't know sort of what to do about it. I've spoken to a lot of the city folks about it. I think eventually E6 got to move.
Correct. Probably. We'll take them in Ward 10.
Yeah, not quite that far west, but I get that. And as we're talking about money and issues and that, I want us to prioritize what we do with E6. You know, so it better serves the demographic probably that it needs to be serving, but also that in the meantime, and it could be a considerable amount of time, we make it safe for the residents in Harvard Park and or, you know, even drivers, passengers. So I suggested one thing that, well, then maybe we just ought to make it a street. I mean, maybe we just ought to widen the whole thing and make it a street and everybody use it. And I came to that conclusion because we have some industries down at the end of 9th and Princeton who use big trucks. And I asked them, so how are you going to get your supplies in and out when the 9th Street is dead-ended at the underpass? And they said, well, we'll just use 10th Street and Princeton or Cornell, or which are all residential streets and haven't been used, you know, to accommodate now more industrial traffic. So we're creating, I think, a confluence here of large vehicles using what has been historically residential streets or shortcuts to do their work. And there's something not as viable about the plan as I think there should be. And I don't know that there's a simple solution.
Yeah, that plan's not finalized.
Yeah.
So that's something we'll have to work towards.
Yeah. It just, you know, maybe there's something we can do to, and maybe it's stopgap. I mean, if we get a chance to get E6 moved to where it needs to be, but my guess is we're talking longer term, and it just could be complicating for the safety and well-being, I think, of the neighborhood. So just thank you for the opportunity to speak. Didn't know where else to kind of go for it, for maybe the best minds to think comprehensively what we could do. So I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
I forgot to recognize Michael Kokel. He's, if you'd like to stand, he's one of the members newly approved for the International Visitors Commission, so we appreciate your service. I don't know if there's other individuals that were here for appointment. If you are, you can stand, but we appreciate their service. Anybody else wish to address the council? Yeah, it's still time to vote for those who haven't voted today, especially in Ward 6, right? That's good.
I voted.
Yep. So any motion for adjournment?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. We're adjourned.
64 boxes.
Yeah.
He was trying to make sure that he could be there by 7.
Oh, he's going to be. You're going to take your jersey over.
Yeah.